555 timer IC. The 555 timer IC is an integral part of electronic projects. Be it a simple project involving a single 8-bit microcontroller and some peripherals, or a complex one involving system on chips, 555 timer working is involved. These provide time delays as an oscillator and as flip-flop element, among other applications. The 555 timer was first introduced by the American company Signetics Corporation in 1971 as SC555 or NE555. The 555 is still in widespread use due to its low price, ease of use, and stability. It is made by many companies in the original bipolar and low power CMOS types. Depending on the manufacturer, the standard 555 timer package includes 25 transistors, 2 diodes, and 15 resistors on a single chip installed in an 8-pin mini dual inline package. The variants consist of combining multiple chips on one board. However, 555 is still the most popular. Let us look at the pin diagram. So the basic timer circuit consists of 2 op-amp voltage comparators, which are denoted by comparator 1 and comparator 2, the voltage resistive network or the voltage divider network consisting of 3 resistors, resistance which are equal in value, and it consists of the SR flip-flop and a discharging transistor which is represented by Q1. All voltages within this particular timer IC are measured with respect to ground. And this ground is denoted by pin number 1. Because of the voltage divider network, which consists of 3 resistors, the voltage at the non-inverting input terminal of the comparator 2 is fixed to VCC by 3, and the voltage at the inverting terminal of the comparator 1 is fixed to 2/3 VCC, whereas the voltage at this particular point is VCC and here it is connected to ground. So as we have seen in the previous slide, pin number 1 corresponds to ground. So moving on to the second pin, that is the trigger pin, which is denoted by pin number 2. So because of the voltage divider network, the voltage at the non-inverting input terminal of the comparator 2 will be fixed at VCC by 3. And the voltage at the inverting input, that is the trigger voltage that you are going to apply, will be compared with VCC by 3. When the trigger input is less than VCC by 3 of the comparator 2, the output is high. And this output is given to the reset input of the SR flip-flop. So in turn, Q will be equal to 0 and Q bar is equal to 1. And since Q bar is the output of the timer circuit, so Q bar is equal to 1 implies the output of the timer is high. As we are individually looking into the pins. We have finished the first pin and the second pin. The third pin is the output pin, which is given by pin number 3. And this pin number 3 is connected to the Q bar of the SR flip-flop. So this output can be connected in two ways. We can have the output between the pin number 3 and the ground, and this is called as normally offload. If the output is measured between pin number 3 and VCC, it is called as normally onload. The next pin is the pin number 4, that is the reset pin. So 555 timers are reset by applying a negative pulse to this particular pin. This pin is connected to VCC to avoid any false triggering when it is not in use. The next pin is the control voltage, which is given to pin number 5. So this pin is having a fixed voltage of 2/3 VCC. Any external voltage that is applied to this particular terminal will change the threshold as well as the triggering voltage 2/3 VCC. So applying a voltage to this particular pin, the pulse width or the duty cycle of the output waveform can be varied. Next pin is the threshold, which is given by the pin number 6, and this is connected to the non-inverting input of the comparator 1. The voltage at this particular pin will be compared with 2/3 VCC at the inverting input. When the voltage at this pin is greater than 2/3 VCC, the output of the comparator will be high and the flip-flop will reset, that is Q will be equal to 1 and Q bar will be equal to 0. So when Q bar is equal to 0, the output will be low. Next is the discharge pin. Discharge pin corresponds to pin number 7, and this pin is connected to the collector of the transistor, which is denoted by Q1. This is an NPN transistor, so this is the collector terminal, this is the base, and this is the emitter. So this is basically acting like a switch. So when the output is high, that means when Q bar is equal to 1 and Q is equal to 0, the transistor Q1 will be off and hence will act like a open circuit to the externally connected capacitor. When the output is low, that means Q bar is equal to 0 and Q is equal to 1 of the SR flip-flop, this Q1, that is the transistor Q1, is on and it will act like a short circuit to the externally connected capacitor. So when we are making use of this particular timer as a monostable multivibrator or a stable multivibrator, we usually connect a capacitor at the external side. So this particular pin basically will act like a short or an open circuit depending upon what is the output of the SR flip-flop, specifically what will be the output of Q bar. So the last pin that we have is pin number 8, which is the supply voltage, and for the 555 timer, the supply voltage will vary from +5 volt to +18 volt. One important thing that you need to note is, in order to understand the working of this internal circuit, you need to know the working of the comparator and you need to know the working of the SR flip-flop. Also, you need to know the working of the transistor as a switch. So, coming to the important features of the 555 timer. So, the 555 timer operates from a wide range of power ranging from 5 volt to plus 18 volt that we have seen earlier. And it has sinking and sourcing of the load current up to 200 milliamps. And the external components should be properly selected so that the timing intervals can be made into several minutes along with the frequencies exceeding several hundreds of kilohertz. And the 555 timer can drive a transistor logic, that is the TTL logic, due to its high current output. Another important feature is that it has a temperature stability of 50 parts per million per degree Celsius change in temperature, which is almost equivalent to 0.005% per degree Celsius. And the duty cycle of the timer is adjustable. Also, the maximum power dissipation per package is around 600 milliwatts, and its trigger and reset inputs has logic compatibility. So these are the important features of the 555 timer. Next, moving on to the modes of operation of the 555 timer. So basically there are three modes. We can operate it as an A-stable, monostable, or a bistable. So what are these three operating modes? Let us look into it individually. So A-stable mode means there will be no stable level at the output. So the output will be swinging between high and low. And this character of unstable output is used as a clock or a square wave output for many applications. Monostable mode means in this configuration, you have one stable state and one unstable state. The stable state can be chosen either as high or low by the user. If the stable output is set as high, that is equal to 1, the output of the timer will be high. At the application of an interrupt, the timer output turns low. Since the low state is unstable, it goes to high automatically after the interrupt passes. Similar is the case for a low stable, monostable mode. Next, coming to the third state or the third mode, that is the bistable mode. In the bistable mode, both the output states are stable. At each interrupt, the output changes from low to high and vice versa and stays there. For example, say if we have a high output, it will go low. Once it receives an interrupt, it stays low till the next interrupt changes the status. So if you want to understand the working principle of the A-stable multivibrator and monostable multivibrator, you can browse into the similar topics which will be uploaded in the upcoming videos. Thank you for watching.